Hello everyone, welcome back. This is part two of the presentation on frequency distributions. Today we're going to pick it up with measures of central tendency and dispersion. So we're going to start things off with talking about measures of central tendency, and then we'll cover measures of dispersion. But basically these are numbers that we use to describe what data looks like. One of the things that you will hear us use a lot in this class, and there are numbers that I'll often point you to, like go find this number and report it back, are measures of central tendency and dispersion. We use these numbers a lot to help us get a sense of what does our data look like. We're going to talk in more detail about what each of these things are, but these are the words you're going to need to get real comfortable with. Descriptive statistics are the workhorse of basic statistical analysis. And so, yeah, here we go. First one up is the mean. The mean is a measure of central tendency, and that whole that expression, central tendency, is getting at the idea of what is happening in the middle, right? Like, it assumes that your data is going to have a shape, all data has a shape, and that when you're looking at data that runs the number line, that data is going to have a middling part, and that ideally, most of your observations are going to occur around the middle. So knowing what the middle is gives you an idea of what your data, you know, what it's looking like. This is the most useful if you have interval ratio data, although you can use the mean for other types of data. Sometimes the mean is not helpful. We'll talk about those situations, but right off the bat, I want you to know a couple of things about the mean. So the mean uses every value in a variable to calculate what is the one number that is the mean. It is a type of average. Each variable only has one value for the mean, and sometimes it can take on an unrealistic value. So I think one that's pretty common is that you would hear, you know, the typical household has 2.3 children or 2.5 children. That 0.3 or 0.5, that's what I mean by unrealistic. Like, there's no such thing as a 0.5 of a person. And yet, because the mean is a mathematical calculation, you can have a decimal place. The other thing to keep in mind about the mean is that it is heavily influenced by really large or really small values relative to where most of the data are. And those are called outliers. The thing about the mean is that because it's calculated by taking all of the values and adding them up together and then dividing by the total number, if you've got a couple numbers in there that are really big or really small, it's going to influence the overall value that you get for the mean. The mean is symbolized with the mu symbol. That's this little piece of, I don't know, what is that, Greek? Latin? Some other language. But that is the symbol for the mean. When you see that, I want you to start associating that symbol with the average, particularly the mean. I'm going to walk through this in some examples, but let's go ahead and cover what I mean by the median and the mode as well, and then we'll look at them visually. So the median is the true middle of a group of observations. So if you have a variable that's runs the number line, the median is going to be the exact middle. The 50 percentile is also the value of the median. If you have a perfectly symmetrical normal distribution, the value of the median and the mean would be the same number. The median, oh, I forgot to tell my joke. The median is not just those things in the middle of the road, you know, the grassy area where people crash. I mean, you know, the buffer zone. Okay, that joke really doesn't land well when you're just saying it to the screen. It's even perhaps worse just saying it in a room by myself compared to doing it in a classroom and just getting 20 faces looking at me like, are you really for real right now, lady? But anyway, the median. The way that the median works is that you would sort all of the values of a variable, either from smallest to largest or largest to smallest. You would count the number of observations, and it's the exact middle value. So if you have an odd number of values or units of analysis, then it's pretty easy. But if the number of values is even, then it's the average of those two middle numbers. There's actually a little formula you can use to calculate the median. I never ask you to do this. We will always look up the median and the mode using Excel or R because they're consistent. The program is less likely to make mistakes, especially small little mathematical mistakes. And this, honestly, is not really a math class. This is about understanding what numbers are telling us class. All right, so the mode. The mode is the value of the item that occurs with the most frequently in a series of observations. So you would only use the mode, I mean, quite honestly, the mode's pretty boring. We only use the mode when the median and the mean are not helpful. Oh, I forgot to say one last thing about the median. I'm so sorry. The median is really useful if you know you have extreme values in your data, because the median is not influenced by the actual values of the data. It's only influenced by the number of observations and what is the exact middle point. So if you know you have outliers, you should use the median. So the mode, you can have more than one mode. You can have a bimodal distribution or trimodal. Most of the time though, the median or the mean are the workhorses. They're the ones that are going to be telling you something about where is the middle area of the data. But every so often, the mean and the median don't really tell you what you need to know, and then the mode has its time to shine because it can say, like, look, this data looks really crazy, but most of our observations are out here in this one area, and so it's useful to use the mode. So the way that we look at this stuff is through histograms. Histograms are a distribution, it's a picture, and it shows you what your data looks like when your data is measured as an interval or ratio data. So this is an example of a histogram. It's showing us the percent high school dropout for the states. And the way that the histogram works is that what's on the vertical axis, the y-axis, is the frequency. It's giving us a count of how many observations occur in each of these groups. And then along the x-axis, the horizontal axis, this is the percentage of high school dropout. So the x-axis is showing you the breakdown of the variable, whereas the y-axis is showing you how many observations fit into that grouping. We use these all the time. It is when you take your first cut of data and you want to know, what does my data look like? Is it really pretty? Is it wiggity-wag? Are there some crazy outliers happening? Is everything kind of clumped nicely in the middle, or is it spread out? You need to know these things about your data because it will have a huge ramification on what your statistical analyses look like when you go in and use this data to build a model to predict behavior or outcomes. The shape of your data is really, really important, and the best way to convey what your data looks like is by looking at it in a picture form. So in this histogram, this is actually like a kind of normalish looking histogram, meaning that there's a big clump of data in the middle. And how do I know there's a big clump of data in the middle? It's because that's where the tallest bars are. Another word for those bars is bins. And if you look along the x-axis, each of these bars represents a certain interval. So it starts over here at 2% and then goes to 2.5, and then 2.5 to 3, 3 to 3.5, 3.5 to 4, and so on and so forth. So there's like four bins that are the tallest, and each of those have about 7 states in them. Like that general area, that's the middle. And so when you look at that dotted line, that's identifying where the mean is. You would look at that and be like, well, does the mean kind of fit in where the middle clump of data is? And this is an example of like when you're looking at real life data, it's not always perfect. It's not always pretty. So it's a gut check. It's kind of like, meh, yeah, kind of, pretty much, sort of. Like that's an acceptable answer for whether or not the mean is occurring in the middle of this distribution of data. So here are the actual steps on how to interpret a histogram. So when you make a histogram, and I'm going to ask you, like, interpret the pattern in the histogram or explain the frequency distribution, these are the steps by which you do this process. So step one is you identify the variable. It's the percent high school dropout in the states. You identify which category has the most observations in it. And in this case, there's four categories. So you would say there's four bins that are the tallest. But if you just look at this sort of central clump that starts at the 4% and goes up to 5.5%, Each of those have about 7 states in them, and if you added them together, there would be 21. So there's about 21 states that have a percent high school dropout that range between 4 and 5.5%. I'm going to say that again because it's kind of a mouthful. And that basically answers like the next 3 questions. So there are 3 categories that are in the middle that are the tallest. Each of those categories have 7 states in them. So there are roughly 21 states that have a percent high school dropout rate between 4 and 5.5%. And I would say that, yeah, the data pretty much clusters together, although there is a little clump of data out here in the 7.5-8%, and then there's another little clump that's in the 2 to 2.5. It's totally your call if you think that those are outliers or not. I think probably not outliers, but it might be borderline. I don't know. Sometimes the judgment of an outlier is something that you make based off of your own gut check. There's like a fancy little way in statistics to determine whether or not an outlier has influence, because sometimes you can have an outlier, but it's not so far out as to influence a mathematical model. But then sometimes you know you're gonna have an influential outlier, but honestly, that's like statistics class 2 or 3. So, which also is not a thing. We don't have multiple stats classes for undergrads. But if you go to grad school, you might learn how to calculate whether or not an outlier has influence. So I've been talking a little bit about distributions, and I keep mentioning normal distribution. I need to just put the cards on the table and tell you what is a normal distribution. A normal distribution is a theoretical concept. It is something that can occur on its own in nature, and like a normal distribution height is one, weights can be one, they occur in nature. But when we talk about humans and behavior, or we calculate information or gather information that's based off of human choices or behavior, we don't always get beautiful normal distributions because, you know, we study people and people be cray. But the theoretical normal distribution is a really important part of statistical analysis. And a lot of times we want to assume that our data will behave normally. Even if it doesn't always look normal, sometimes it's big enough that we can assume it's normal. I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself because we are going to talk more about this when we do sampling. But things to know about the normal distribution. In a pure theoretical normal distribution, the value of the mean and the median are the same number, and I've identified that through that vertical line going straight up the middle of that hill. A normal distribution has most of the observations clumped around the value of the mean or the median, and then it tapers off into these cute little tails on either side. A true normal distribution, exactly half of the observations are to the left of the mean, and half of the observations are to the right. So if you were thinking about it in percentages, 50% of the values are to the left, 50% of the values are to the right. This becomes important later on because we will use the area under the curve as a way to tell how is our data performing. So everything under the curve sums to 1 or 100%. And we know that because in a true normal distribution, these things are split equally half and half. So when you add them together, you get 100% or 1. But in social sciences, we get to play with some real gnarly distributions too. So I want to introduce you to the negative and the positive skewed distribution. First up is the negative distribution. These are cases when the outliers, so you can see the direction of the tail is like going way off to the left, this is a case where the value of the mean is going to be smaller than the value of the median. So a few extremely low values are going to pull the mean towards those lower numbers and away from the central clump of the distribution, which is why you should use the median in these cases. I've given a couple examples up here where you can see where would this happen in real life or out in the wild. A positive distribution is where the value of the mean is greater than the value of the median. So a few really big numbers are pulling that value of the mean towards their bigger values. This happens all the time when you look at numbers, so income especially, which is why you will pretty much always see numbers that have to do with salaries or housing values or rents given in their median. Because the median is not influenced by the actual values, the median is influenced by where's the exact middle value. I don't care what the numbers are, just where is the middle. So here's some examples from like real data and sort of when to use the mean versus the median. If your distribution is normal or normal-ish, then you want to use the mean. And only because people tend to understand the mean. Like it's a more accessible term than the median. Both of these numbers are averages though. So when you just say the average, blah, 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 you could be talking about a median or you could be talking about a mean. And this is one of those things that like once you understand the difference between median and mean and people just willy-nilly use the term average, it starts to drive you a little bananas. But you know, your time will come when you get really wiggity about stats, language, usage. So let's interpret this histogram down here. So this in this histogram, this is showing us the variable is the percent of the adult population with a high school diploma in St. Louis City neighborhood. So look at my hometown in 2010. So the percentage of adults with a high school diploma is being shown along the x-axis. And then I got a little fancy here. I'm showing you the percentage of census tracts on the left. And on the right, I'm giving you the frequency, the actual count of census tracts. I know, I can't help it. Sometimes I'm just a wee bit extra. But the thing I want to draw your attention to here is that both values of the mean and the median are in the middle. They're pretty close to each other. And they're kind of close to that tallest bin, the central clump of data. So between 30 and 35% of the adult population in the city of St. Louis, about 27 census tracts have between a 30 and 35% of the adult population with a high school diploma. Wow, that was kind of something. Honestly, I would have hoped that it'd be higher, but it's sometimes hard to finish high school. For reals. So when you compare the tallest bin to the values of the mean and the median, one of the things you'll ask yourself is, do I feel like the value of the mean is representative? Is it close enough? This is an example of yes. The value of the mean and the median are close enough to the central clump of data that, yeah, it totally makes use of it. You should use the mean. Here's where you would not want to use the mean. And these are both examples of when you have skewed data. And I went for the extremes here. So the one on the left is showing you the gross domestic product per capita. So these are dollars. And the median here is $4,500. But the mean is $13,300. And the reason why is because the mean is using all the values of the data. And there's some really big numbers out here. Like there's some places, some countries where there's $150,000 gross domestic product per capita. It's also tricky because when you look at the tallest bin, like 80% of all the countries fall in that tallest bin, but that tallest bin has a huge range, 0 to almost 25,000. So this is one of those examples where if you want to give a truer impression of where the actual middle is, you should use the median. Even though both the median and the mean are technically in that tallest bin, I think the difference between 4,500 and 13,000 is meaningful. Like I would much rather have $13,000 than $4,500, but you know, you don't want to mislead your audience with where the true middle of the data lies. So on this other example on the right, you can see this illustrated as well. The median value is 53%. The variable we're looking at is the percent of family households in St. Louis City neighborhoods where at least two members are related. So most of the observations are in that 50 to 60%. So there are just over 40% of census tracts where the percent of households where at least two members are related are between 50 and 60%. But when you look at the dotted lines, the median is closer to the true central clump of data than the mean. And that's because we have a number of census tracts where the percent of households where at least two people are related is really small. And that's pulling the value of the mean towards its extreme. And then we have this beauty. Ugh, man, I love this town. I don't know if you heard the honking. I'm totally recording this in my bedroom. And what this plot is showing you is a histogram of the percent white of voting age population in 2010. And it's showing this to you at the census tract level. And if you're not familiar with census tracts, it's a small unit of geography, and it's roughly equivalent to a neighborhood. In fact, it's something that researchers sometimes use as a proxy for a neighborhood. The city of St. Louis, if you look at the percent white, the mean is 40% white, the median is 37% white. So if you just saw those numbers by themselves, you'd be like, man, St. Louis, look at you with your integration. But really, when you can see the distribution of the data, you can see that those numbers are misleading. Because where's the tallest bin? Well, the tallest bin is way at the extreme, at the far left-hand side of the plot. 35% of census tracts are between 0 and 10% white. Whereas if you look at the other extreme, there's, I don't know, if we add these last few bins together, there's between, you know, 20 to 25% of census tracts that are almost 100% or over 80% white. So this is not a city where people are living side by side with people of different races singing kumbaya. Like, St. Louis is a segregated city. So this is an example of when the mode would be useful, because the mode would tell you that the bin with the highest frequency is this one on the extreme, the 0 to 10%. And that would be a more accurate value. It is telling you where most of the observations fall. So next up, we have measures of dispersion. Measures of dispersion are another summary measure that's used alongside of measures of central tendency. So most of the time, when you see a measure of central dispersion, they're with some other number, usually either the mean or the median. And the thing that's really important about dispersion is that they give you a sense of the spread of your data. So central tendency tells you something about the middle, dispersion tells you something about the extremes, or the amount of variability in the middle. These are super important for later statistical analyses. And the other big thing to know about dispersion is that it is telling us a sense of how much wiggliness is in the data, or I guess a more technical term for wiggliness is variability. So first up, let's do a simple one, the range. The range is where you take the minimum value and the maximum value, subtract the minimum from the maximum, and that number is the range. So bigger numbers for range give you a sense of like, well, this data is really spread out. Smaller numbers indicate the data is like pretty compact. But the range is, you know, honestly kind of boring because it doesn't tell you hardly anything about what's happening inside of your data. Quantiles or centiles tell you about the insides of your data. Percentiles give you the percentage that is below a certain value or cutoff. So example, look at this little baby. That is my firstborn, Cedric, when he's about 7 weeks old. He is so squishy, and now he is 13 and bigger than me. But anywho, when Cedric was born, he was a monster baby. He was the biggest baby born in that hospital. Like, it's crazy. I gained like over 100 pounds with that pregnancy. Just bananas. But when he was born, they measure, you know, how long your kid is, how much they weigh, the size of their head. And then they tell you on a chart how your baby compares to all other babies. Well, I don't know what it is, but maybe it was like hopped up on hormones or the anesthesia that they give you for a C-section, because I did not push out no 10 pound, I don't even know how many ounces baby. He wasn't even lined up to come out correctly. So yeah, totally a C-section baby. But when they show you the chart, they showed it to me, I was like, oh, my baby's, like, amazing. He was in the 99th percentile. Like, he's just he was a big baby. And it wasn't until he was about 2 years old, we went for, you know, a well baby checkup, and the doctor measures him and stuff, and is like, oh, you know, his weight is really coming into the 50th percentile. It was in the 75th percentile. And I had a gasp of, like, 75. Like, that's a C. Starting to get really upset, like, oh, my baby. And the doctor had to be like, okay, mom, take a breath. Like, you do not want to maintain your kid in the 99th percentile for weight. Like, because then your kid weighs more than 99% of all other children who are being measured. So it's like, okay, yeah, that's right. That's right. Calm down. It's not a competition. So that's the thing to keep in mind about centiles. They tell you how much or how many are below a certain cut point. Look at that cute squishy baby. Other centiles or quantiles that you'll see are the quartile. These are four equal cuts of the data, so 25, 50, 75. The quintile is five cuts. The interquartile range is one that you'll see a lot. In fact, there's like this five number spread that is considered sort of best practice in summary stats to report, and that is the minimum value, the 25th percentile, the 50th percentile or the mean, the 75th percentile, and the maximum. With those five numbers, you know pretty much everything you need to know about what's happening in that data without having to see the actual data. But the gold standard of dispersion is standard deviation. The standard deviation measures the amount of dispersion or variability or wiggliness of the data around the mean. So the most common and probably the most sought after combination of values to report is the mean and its standard deviation. Because if you know the standard deviation, you know about the shape and the feel of the distribution. Let me explain. So the rule of thumb, and thumbs made me think of plants, and plants made me think of like green, and then pusheen and plants, so that's how that picture ended up there. So if the standard deviation compared to the value of the mean is roughly greater than a third of the size of the mean, then the distribution may be too skewed, too stretched out towards the extreme, for the mean to be a good measure of where's the actual middle. Let me keep going. Okay, in a pure symmetrical distribution, you're gonna get a value of the standard deviation that's really small compared to whatever the value of the mean is. So if the value for standard deviation is small, that's an indication that that data is really compact and that it's probably normal. It's in that nice bell-shaped curve. The other good thing to know about standard deviation is that when you know that value, the way that it works is that you would take that value and you would add it to the value of the mean, and then you would also subtract it to the value of the mean. And whatever those two numbers are, that's considered one standard deviation away from the mean. If you have a normal distribution, you know you're going to have about 68% of all the observations are going to fall within that one unit movement to the left or to the right. If you do that again and move two standard deviations away from the mean on either side, you'll have about 95% of the observations. And with three standard deviations, you've got pretty much everybody. And this is a really handy rule to use, and it helps you to know, even if my data doesn't look beautifully normal, does it behave normal enough that I can assume other attributes of a normal distribution to my data? So why do we care about this? We care because standard deviation and variance tell us something about the data. They tell us how it is spread out and if that spread is even or leans to one side or the other. If the value for the standard deviation is relatively small, then we can assume that most of the data lie close to the mean. If your standard deviation is zero, it means all your values are at the mean and something really wiggity weird is happening and you need to double check what's going on. So the general rule then is that the larger the standard deviation, the greater the dispersion of the data. Now again, this all is relative to the mean because the value of the mean is part of the calculation for standard deviation. So when we get into the weeds of data and we're looking at means and standard deviations, I will ask this question, right? Like, how does the standard deviation value compare to the value of the mean? Is it bigger? Is it smaller? Because these things are relative to each other. The rule of the third is a way to decide whether or not you want to describe your variable in terms of the mean or the median, or maybe you need to go and look at it and it's one of those rare times when the mode is actually the most useful. Alright, so that wraps it up for our discussion of dispersion. I hope this was helpful and you were able to fill in the remainder of note packet number 2.